My name is Martin Sanchez, and my wife is Sylvia Sanchez, now the Sanchez family. And we're here just to tell you about our story. I was 13 years old when I first came here to the United States. The way we crossed the border was something. I didn't recommend to nobody. And then I understand what's the meaning of leave your family, leave your everything to come over here to look for better life.
I came to the United States when I was 5. I came with an aunt in the car.
When I met Sylvia, it was 1984. I was working and we were working together. And then we started dating and then we get married at 1986.
We were very different. Me and Martin are very different at how he was brought up and how I was brought up.
When I get to this country, I'm really, really, really desperate to get work. It's not easy because you have no papers.
It was a struggle that if immigration went into his job or something, they could deport him. But, you know, thank God we did get our residency. And 7 years later, we became citizens.
We became citizens in 2000. And after that, we good. We got our passports. We feel free.
Like you feel like this freedom that you could walk, you know, you could walk around us with your head held up high. We're so glad for the opportunity this country has given us, but we thank God every single minute that we're citizens. We're proud to be citizens, and we even have a son in the service. It makes us very proud. You know, from two people that came from Mexico, became citizens, and we have a son serving this country.
We moved to Arkansas. 2011, we start struggling, looking for church.
I saw a sign for Easter Sunday, and I remember driving, and I used to tell him, don't drive so fast, I need to look at this sign. But I said, you know what, let's go this Sunday and see what it's about.
The first day, I mean, absolutely was like a home. 5 years ago, they launched that Spanish group, and then we start helping them.
And I mean, we become very close with Pablo and Flor. I mean, we're like family. They're always there for us and we're always there for them. We couldn't have found a better church.
We've been through a lot in these last five years. My wife in 2017, lost her leg.
I had an amputation. Maybe a year later, our daughter was diagnosed with, our oldest was diagnosed with breast cancer. 2 months ago, we went through COVID. But you know what? God has never let us down. He's always been by our sides, held our hand. I started volunteering at the Compassion Center. I translate there. It's just amazing helping other people. And Compassion Center, they're amazing the way they feed these people, help them. I have learned so much from them. Martin started helping. He ministers to people at Compassion. He's really good at it, so. I think that's why he likes doing it.
When we start going to Compassion, I can see people, you know, like the necessity that I feel. And some people made me cry at Compassion.
Both Compassion Center and Cross Church are doing an awesome job reaching out to people. Sometimes people, like in the Hispanic community, they think it's just the white church, you know, it's just for white people. No, it's not. It's for whatever race. Marshallese, you know, Salvadorans, Mexicans, for whatever, they welcome you.
And I don't think that God gonna say, you know what, your color, I don't wanna help you. You're white, I wanna help you. You Hispanic, I don't wanna help you. We all one. We are really, really glad that we moved here and we met all this family in Cross Church. We thankful to God because we're here.
Well, what an incredible story that is of the Sanchez family. I want to welcome everybody here at our Fayetteville campus. And also, we have joining us everybody online. We welcome you. We have our 9:30 service at Springdale and 9:30 service at 11, or excuse me, at 9:30 at Pinnacle Hills as well. We've already had an 8 a.m. at Fayetteville. We got people in the overflow. Everybody here at Fayetteville, why don't we welcome everybody else wherever they're watching today? Well, This is a unique thing that we are doing, connecting via video at all of our campuses, and so we are really excited about that. If you're brand new to our church, welcome. We don't normally do it like this, but we are in a season of a vision series where we're talking about the next decade of our church, of who we want to be, and what are we going to do as a church. We have called this the decade of love. If you have walked around and wondered, why is the word love everywhere in our church? Well, it's because we're in the decade of love here at our church. And so if you have missed the last few weeks, or if you're brand new to our church, let me catch you up on where we've been the last several weeks. Or if you've been here every week, let me just catch you back up and reiterate where we have been. Of what is the decade of love really all about? What does it stand for? The L in the love stands for legacy. What we want to do is over the next 10 years leave a legacy of doing all that we could to reach the next generation and to position this church for the future. Last week we talked about the O in the love, that is obedience to Christ's commission. That's how we love lost people in our community and world. It's a lot about missions, and we've announced several things alongside of that. One cool thing we announced last week is that our very first church plant is going to be in London, England, and we have had overwhelming response to that, and so we can't wait to see what God's going to do there. Today we're actually talking about the V, the vulnerable aspect of the decade of love vision. And so we're going to talk about how God calls us to love the poor and many other people within that vulnerable category. So we'll talk about that here in just one second. And then next week, we will close out the decade of love series by talking about loving pastors and missionaries. You may say, okay, well, I'm not really interested in that one. The other things I can get involved in. And I want you to just understand, you're wrong if you have that perspective. You very much so can be a part of the decade of love by loving those who are called of God to serve him full time. And so we're going to talk about some various ways that you can get involved next Sunday. So we're excited about that. And so if you got a Bible today, here's where we're going to go. We're going to talk about loving the vulnerable. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 25, and we'll get there in just 1 minute. As we've been saying, and as you just saw in the video, just 2 weeks from now, October 25th, is our 150th anniversary as a church. A lot of special things planned. One of the special things that we're going to do as a part of that service is give you a commitment card that on that day you will have an option of where do you want to invest your life over the next decade, or at least to get started in the decade. Is it the L, the O, the V, or the E? We want every person in our church, whether you're a member or regular attender of our church, to find a lane of love that God is calling you to minister to other people through that. That's where we're headed over the next decade. Now, I've shared a same passage with you every single week throughout this series because it's the foundation of the decade of love and really where we're going as a church. It's Matthew 22, just a few chapters before our passage for today. Jesus said this, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." So what we're doing and what we have done over the last few weeks and then today and next week is we're really wondering together, how can we play this out together as a church? How do I as an individual Christian, you as an individual Christian, how do we play this out, this great passage here from Jesus? And today we're going to talk about loving the vulnerable in our community and world. If you look at that Matthew 22 passage, you may say, so I guess we're talking about the loving your neighbor side of that. And again, I would just help maybe course correct you here. Is that we're really talking about all of it, loving God and loving people. You may have wondered before when you hear me or one of our other pastors say, hey, how do you love God? And you hear us encourage you to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And maybe you've been a little confused of how do I actually put that into practice? Well, Matthew 22 and Matthew 25 are going to link these two things together. How do you love God? Well, you love people. And when you love God, you love people. And when you love people, you love God. These two things go hand in hand together. Now, it's been really interesting, and I shared this a few weeks ago with you on Vision Sunday, that as we knew where we were headed before COVID related to the decade of love, it was interesting that this vulnerable word got brought up over and over and over to where it's really common language now within the American society of caring for the vulnerable. Now, the biblical definition is a little bit different here, although they all play together in some way. But we're going to talk about that today. And what I want you to understand is this. We started the decade of love in March when COVID hit, not in September when we first announced this. And so you've been a part of loving the vulnerable through our church, whether you even realize it or not. cool thing is we're already doing so much as a church, but what we want to do is expand that and put an exclamation point on what we are already doing. Make sense? Now let's dive into the passage, Matthew 25. Let me give you the context here of the passage of what we are headed into today. Jesus is speaking about what he's going to do at the final judgment, all right? The final judgment. He talks about people being gathered before him, and at this time, he's going to separate the sheep from the goats. Now, the sheep are those who are Christians, and the goats are those who are not Christians. And basically, what Jesus is going to share in Matthew 25 is that the sheep at the final judgment will go to heaven, and the goats will go to hell. Now, at the 8 a.m. service this morning, I started to divide the room, and then I realized that I was sending half the room to hell. And so I'll just ixnay that for the last two services here, okay? Jesus talks about sheep, Christians, being people who have cared for the poor. And he talks about goats, people who are not Christians, as people who did not care for the poor. Now, let's just give a logical question. Do lost people care for the poor in our community? Yes or no? Yes. The answer is absolutely yes. We have many lost people who do many good things for the poor in our community. But the point of what Jesus is getting at here is that caring for the poor does not save a person. Jesus, in many ways, is speaking to a group much like I'm speaking to today. He's talking to a bunch of people who are gathered together who may look the part, but ultimately not really know him. To be clear, Jesus is not saying that caring for the poor is the ticket into heaven. To do that would be to disregard basically the rest of the book. And so we don't believe in a works salvation. But here's what is clear from Matthew 25 and the passage that I'm about to read about the sheep, the Christians, and what they really do. It is clear from Matthew 25 that God is incredibly caring of the vulnerable. And he's incredibly caring of the poor and sick and all the categories we're going to talk about today. And so here's what I would say. If you're a sheep in one of these rooms, if you're a sheep there at home, if you know Jesus Christ, here's what I want you to understand about your life. Jesus has a massive expectation upon your life that you would care for the vulnerable. If I could say it even in a broader sense of us, not just individually, but us collectively, Jesus has a massive expectation for what we as a church should do for the poor and for the vulnerable. Now, let's look at Matthew 25. I read this passage to you a few weeks ago. Let's go a little bit deeper on it now. Matthew 25, verse 35 is where we'll begin reading. Jesus says this, "For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me." And then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink?" In other words, they're saying, "Jesus, what are you talking about? Like, when did we see you in prison? When did we see you hungry or naked? Like, when did that all happen?" He says this in verse 38, "And when did we see a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me." Jesus says, whenever you care for the vulnerable, you are caring for me. Whenever you love people who are vulnerable, you are ultimately loving me. It's interesting. Whenever you look at Jesus in the Gospels, the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, what do we see? If you just follow the pattern of Jesus' life, you're going to see that he loves the vulnerable again and again and again. He cares for the afflicted. He heals the sick. And what I'm encouraging you to do as an individual believer within our church is to give your life for the sake of the vulnerable in our community and in our world. This is nothing new for our church. You've heard me talk about various things in our history over the last several weeks, and it's been so cool. We're going to lay out some really cool things for you on the 150th anniversary about our church history that you're going to love to hear. It's going to be so fascinating. But along the way, we've realized so much of that connects with what we're actually doing for the Decade of Love. Remember what I told you a few weeks ago? Church records indicate that in 1924, our congregation shipped a railroad car loaded with apples, potatoes, canned fruit, and other food to help provide for orphans at the Baptist orphanage in Monticello. Really cool thing, right? 19 years later, 1943, the church was burdened for more mission work in the city and focused on reaching people in the migrant labor camp in Springdale. History is a help to us, is it not? even as you look back to the 1990s, we talked about the blessing of blessing baskets, which is coming up next month in November, where we give a Thanksgiving meal to people and share the gospel with them. This has happened. We have given food to just under 54,000 families since the early 90s through this great ministry. We serve the homeless weekly at Hope for the City right here in Fayetteville. We serve all kinds of people, the vulnerable category, every single week through Compassion NWA and Feed the 479. You say, Nick, why do you talk about all that stuff? Why are you pointing out all that we do as a church? I just want to reiterate to you, this is who we are. This is not a departure from anything that we have been in the past. What we want to do is just further emphasize already what we have done and are doing as a church. Now, I want to go back to the five categories here that we see in Matthew 25, and then we're going to talk a level deeper today on each one of these things, and how does our church live out Matthew 25 for the five categories that are mentioned? What are these five categories? If you're a note taker, I would encourage you to write these down. Here's what they are: the poor, the hungry, the immigrant, the prisoner, and the sick. Those are the five categories that Jesus mentions that are within this vulnerable category. If you wonder, okay, where are we headed in our love for the vulnerable for the next, if you try to say vulnerable over and over, you end up messing it up. The vulnerable. This is going to guide our actions over the next 10 years, these five categories. And so let's talk through these five categories together. Let's talk about the poor first of all, okay? Let's talk about the poor. You know, it's interesting. Again, if you go back to the four Gospels where we find the life records of Jesus, one of the remarkable things about the ministry of Jesus is that he constantly tore down walls through love. In many ways, what we're talking about doing for the next decade of our church is how many walls can we tear down through love? Think about what Jesus did. Jesus showed value to women. He crossed racial lines. He brought people together, and he lifted up the poor as people who are worthy of the kingdom of God. Now, here's where this intersects with your life today, okay? This is what the gospel of Jesus does, no matter if you're watching this at home, in an overflow room, if you're at any one of our campuses in the big rooms, whatever they may be, okay? Wherever you are, here's what you need to understand about Jesus. It doesn't matter what gender you are, what race you are, how much money you do have or don't have. If you will surrender your life to Jesus Christ, you can be forgiven of your sin and you can be saved. That's the hope of the gospel. And so Jesus, throughout his remarkable life, did not say, well, you guys are out, you guys are in. He said, whosoever will, let him come. It's interesting as you look at the Old Testament and it spoke about what Jesus the Messiah would one day ultimately do. All the way back in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 61, of this is what the Messiah will do. Well, Jesus arrives, and in Luke chapter 4, he quotes Isaiah 61 and essentially is saying this, hey, what you guys read about, here it is right here, okay? Here's what he said. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. It's interesting when you look at Matthew 25 and you look at Luke chapter 4, how much those two passages come together and intersect on so much love for the vulnerable. Here's what you need to understand, okay? This is incredibly simple and yet incredibly deep. You never outgrow the statement that I'm about to say. The gospel is for all people. Isn't that a great word for us today? Can we just say that together at every campus? Let's just say that together. The gospel is for all people. So no matter where you came from today, no matter how you're watching this today, no matter the location where you're at, here's what you need to know. Jesus Christ can save you. In the last 2 weeks, we have had 11 different people text in at the end of our service indicating that they have trusted Jesus by faith. Isn't that a great word, church? God's moving, and we ain't even talking about like real hard gospel conversations here. These are just how God is already moving through the decade of love. It's very interesting. Jesus could have said, I've come to speak to the leaders. I've come to speak to the good-looking, the rich, the famous. I've come to speak to those with hair. I'm grateful God didn't limit the groups, right? Jesus said, anybody's in who will come to me. That's the poor. Let's talk about the hungry, okay? God is doing an amazing work through our church already in so many different ways. One of the just exploding ministries of our church is our Compassion Center, and specifically our Feed the 479 ministry. We're feeding so many people here who are hungry in our community. As I mentioned, Hope for the City as well. You can get involved in either one of those things on a weekly basis, serving food to the hungry here. But here's what's awesome. We didn't plan this whatsoever, but in the sovereign plan of God, today is actually Global Hunger Sunday, on the exact day when we're talking about feeding the hungry in our community and in our world. And so I just want to ask a question for every single person here. Is God calling you to love the hungry? I mean, when you hear about the needs in our community, and you often think, well, Northwest Arkansas is so wealthy, and we've got all these big companies, and the University of Arkansas. And what I want you to understand is that we actually have a very high rate of what experts call food insecurity in our own two counties here in Northwest Arkansas. In fact, Compassion Center this past week served a record 500 families through Feed the 479. And you're saying, golly, man, 500 families who are in need of food right here in our own community. And this is not a one-week deal. Literally, it is hundreds and hundreds of families every single week who are being ministered to. And you may think, okay, so is this like a drive-through, like a Chick-fil-A, where we give them a hot meal in a bag and we say, hey, there's your lunch for today? It's actually much deeper than that. Depending on supplies and other factors, we are giving them food for weeks. Literally, it's between 125 pounds and 170 pounds of food that we give to the hungry in the name of Jesus Christ, not only to meet a physical need, but ultimately to meet their deeper spiritual need of trusting Jesus as Lord and Savior. And so if you're a part of our church and you've been listening to all this, you're like, man, I just don't know like where I need to plug into the Decade of Love. I need something easy. I need something to just start out with that's just an easy on-ramp for me. This is about as easy as it gets. Jump on what God's doing at Hope for the City and Fable. Jump on what God's doing through Compassion and NWBA and Feed the 479. This is an easy way to serve Jesus, an easy way to fulfill Matthew 22 of loving God and loving people. Let's talk about the immigrant. How do we love the immigrant as a church? What an incredible story we just heard from the Sanchez family. Is that unbelievable? Just a fantastic family of a family who immigrated here from Mexico and ultimately is a part of our church now, citizens now, active dream teamers in our church serving at the Compassion Center. And now let's talk about this word immigrant, okay? We need to recover this from a biblical standpoint for our conversations today. This word immigration has often been a very politicized term. You hear about that throughout election season in different ways. And I got a hunch, okay? Here's my hunch for everybody in the room at Fayetteville and across the church today. My hunch is you probably have an opinion on how we should handle immigration as a country. I've got some opinions as well. What I want to remind us today is that we are not at a political rally today. We are in church today. And so we operate in a different manner. What we're not talking about today is immigration laws. We believe God gives the authority to governmental leaders that we vote into power, who ultimately can do things in the right manner, whatever that right manner may be. And so by all means, go be a good Christian. We're just a few weeks away from the November election. And this is another opportunity. And you got a myriad of issues where we need to vote our values as biblical, Bible-believing Christians. Encourage you wholeheartedly to go out and vote and make your voice be heard, okay? Here's where it comes to today, though. What we are not to take a vote upon is our love for the immigrant. Let me say that to you again. What we are not to take a vote upon is whether or not we are going to love the immigrant. We are to treat all people with dignity and honor as someone created in the image of God. And remember what we said, how do we love God? We do that by loving people. And here Jesus specifically points out those who are immigrants from other places who come to your own backyard, to your community, that you are to love them well. And by doing that, you are actually loving people. Jesus described himself in these terms. I was a stranger and you welcome me. What's he talking about here? He's essentially saying this. There were immigrants who came into your community and you loved them with Christian love. And because you did that for them, you were ultimately doing that for me. That's the point of the passage. Now, in the Bible, we see a couple different words for an immigrant. We see the word stranger mentioned here. We also see the word sojourner in much of the Bible. Listen to what God told his people in the book of Exodus. He says, "You shall not oppress a sojourner. You know the heart of a sojourner, for you were sojourners in the land of Egypt." We are to love them well, treat them fairly, and to not oppress them. And here's my question for every one of us today, wherever you're watching from. If not the church, who will? It's really the question for us. If the church will not love the immigrant, then who in the world will? We have a thriving Espanol ministry here at the church, and I was speaking with our Espanol pastor, Pablo Doubt, this summer, and he was just updating me on so much that was going on in our Espanol ministry and just a fascinating work of God there. And out of a good heart, I said, "Pablo, will there ever not be a need for an Espanol ministry?" My heart being, will there ever be a time when the two congregations come together? And we don't have an English service and an Espanol service, but man, we have just cross church together, right? Just both congregations together. And he said something that was very interesting to me that I'd never thought about, and it was very helpful to me. He said, "That will not happen as long as there's immigration." His point being was this: you're always going to have people immigrating to America who English is not their first language. And so for us to reach them with the gospel, for them to be able to come to church and actually get something out of church, we need a Spanish option for them. And I thought, Pablo, you're a lot smarter than I am right there. Just a good, good word right there. God has given us the privilege. Let's say to you again, the privilege of loving the immigrant right here in Northwest Arkansas. And may God find us faithful to love these people by welcoming them into our church and by sharing the hope that is only found in the Lord Jesus Christ together. Let's talk about a fourth thing. What's the fourth category Jesus mentions in this passage? He talks about the prisoner. The prisoner. Now, you may know this, you may not know this, but we have actually several people involved in jail ministry or prison ministry in our church. In fact, we've been a part of this for about 20 plus years, working with a local chaplain of a specific correctional facility here in our community. And it's an amazing thing. I mean, we have seen so many people, countless lives, literally just under 5,000 people who have been won to faith in Christ through the chaplaincy ministry of one of our local correctional facilities. And so God's doing an amazing work. Now, you've got a lot of people who meet Jesus in jail, or they meet Jesus in prison. And so one of the major needs for discipleship for them is, how can they get their hands on a Bible? Where can we give them God's word? And so God's opened a door for us to do that. And as just a part of the flow out of the heart of the Decade of Love, and because of your faithful support and generous giving to our church, we are pumped to announce to you today that we are giving 1 year's worth of Bibles to the Washington County Detention Center, which is about 2,000 Bibles that each inmate will get when they're in there, as well as providing each county deputy their personal Bible. So church, thank you. That's an incredible work. Can we just praise God for that? Thank you for making that happen, church. And another cool thing, as if that is not enough, we're at the very beginning stages of this. Literally, it got approved this week. And I'll keep it very general. One of our correctional facilities, you may know this, you may not know this, but actually the inmates have access to tablets that they can check out and they can watch or listen to things. And we just got approval this past week in one of our correctional facilities, and we'll take this to as many as want it. But we will actually just got approval to put all of our cross-church sermons and services on those tablets so that these inmates can hear the gospel, hear the word of God. And so that's just an incredible thing. And so praise God for that open door as well. And again, we look forward to doing whatever we can towards this kind of ministry. And God's already opening up doors, and that's evident. But here's what I want to say. And I say this because I have no idea who's out there watching today. I don't know everybody here in the Fayetteville campus room at our 9:30 service, or those of you in Overflow watching online or Pinnacle or Spring. I don't know who's all out there today, but I'm reminded regularly that I have no idea who's watching out there because I hear certain things. But I just want to say to everybody, if you're in local or state government or you work in one of our correctional facilities in some capacity, We just want you to know we want to be there. We want to help. We want to bring the gospel of Jesus to as many inmates as possible. We want to bring hope and encouragement to these inmates. We want to help in whatever way we can in as many jails, prisons across Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world, okay? And so if God would put it on your heart, if you're in one of those positions of authority who could open a door for us, we are ready to walk through this as a church. And here's what I'm going to ask you as an individual person within our church. Could it be that God is calling you to work in one of our correctional facilities? Could it be that you are going to be the physical representation of our church and of Jesus into one of these correctional facilities where you can take the gospel? We're all open. Let's pray about that together, that God may open up doors here in the future. Now, let me talk about the final thing today. Let's talk about the sick, okay? One of the great privileges that we as pastors and our staff get to operate with in life is we get to be with people during their dying days. And there's some significant spiritual events and spiritual moments that take place in the midst of people's dying days. You know, all of our bodies are broken. All of our bodies get sick, and ultimately, stats are overwhelming. One out of every one person dies, okay? We're all headed there unless the Lord comes back. But while our bodies get sick and broken, something that we often don't talk about is sometimes our minds do the very same thing. They really do. Did you understand and did you realize that 1 in 5 American adults have a diagnosable condition of mental health within a given year? Let me say that to you again. 1 in 5 Americans have a diagnosable condition of mental health within a given year. And so one of the ways that we want to dive into this as a part of the Decade of Love, specifically not only just the physical health of people, which we'll continue to always do, but also we want to dive into the mental health component of ministry. We've dabbled in this at different times over the years, but we want to make just a headfirst dive into this as a part of the Decade of Love. We're going to give you more information in the coming days, but we're going to be beginning a formal counseling ministry here at Cross Church. And we want you to visit this website today if you have time. And if you're in need, just crosschurch.com/counseling. We'll put that up on the screens for you at all of our campuses. And that's going to give you a lot of information on there. There are actually state laws that prohibit us from doing this and providing counseling services beyond our members. And so this is a service specifically for Cross Church members. And so if you're going through something with your mental health, or maybe you've come just to an issue that you cannot resolve on your own, we want to help, okay? And we will have a formal counselor on our staff who will begin to meet with people. Part of what that counselor will do as well is they will begin to funnel out to various great organizations that we're already partnered with in our community. We have great counseling ministries that we are already partnered with as a church, and so it may be that you come to us and we say, hey, you really need to go see this person, and we're going to be a funnel and a resource to you in that way. So we're very excited about that, and really we're excited about all these ways that we're going to careful for the vulnerable. And I hope that you'll jump on board in some facet and in some way as we make the Decade of Love a priority in this manner and in this lane over the next 10 years. We've talked a lot about loving the poor, or in other words, loving the vulnerable today. But as we close, I just want to make this personal. And I want to ask you, have you ever been vulnerable with God? We all meet those people from time to time where we say, golly, I just had a wall up, man. It's like I was just speaking to a wall. Something's wrong there. And you may say, hey, I'm one of those people with a wall. But I want to ask you specifically, do you have a wall up against God? Have you ever brought down the wall and really dealt with your sinful condition before the Lord? All that we've talked about today about Jesus and his life and how the gospel's for all people. Jesus can save anybody. Doesn't matter where you've come from, what you've done, what you did last night, you can be saved. That's the hope of the gospel. Jesus, in what is known as the greatest sermon ever preached, called the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said this: blessed are the poor in spirit. Jesus calling us to a poverty of spirit. You may wonder, maybe you've read that before, and you think, what in the world was Jesus talking about when he said that? I love the way Billy Graham responded to that question. He said, Jesus also said, there is another kind of spiritual poverty, one that we should seek. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What did he mean? Simply this, we must be humble in our spirits. He suggests this. He says, if you put the word humble in place of the word poor, you will understand what he meant. You got to be humble in spirit. In other words, when we come to God, we must realize our own sin and our spiritual emptiness and our poverty. We must not be self-satisfied or proud in our hearts, thinking we don't really need God. I wonder how many people watching today and attending in person today have a wall of pride built up between you and God. It's brick after brick after brick of you building a wall in your life that you essentially say this, God, I don't need you. Today, could it be in your own heart and in your own life that God wants to tear down that wall? And how does that happen? It begins by you being vulnerable with God. You recognizing your spiritual poverty once and for all, where you say, you know what? I've tried to make myself right with God, but I couldn't. I tried to do all the right things, but I couldn't. I tried to change on my own, but I couldn't. And for the very first time, just come face to face with God and say, Jesus, I cannot do this alone. And for the very first time, would you trust in his death and in his resurrection to save you? Just like the 11 other people the last 2 weeks at our church have done the very same thing. Would you do that today? Can we bow our head and close our eyes at all of our campuses? If you're watching online, you're in the overflow room, you just bow your head as well. And today, if that's you, if you say, Nick, I know that you're speaking directly to me. I just, golly, man, God's gripping my heart right now of my need for Jesus. Now, what a moment of grace this is. This is not a bad thing that God is doing in your life. This is a great thing God is doing in your life. But would you tear down that wall between you and God? Would you take down those bricks of pride, self-sufficiency? And would you come to God for the very first time? You may say, Nick, how do I do that? I don't know what you're talking about. Would you just pray a simple prayer to God? Like you're just speaking directly to Jesus. You're not praying to me. You're not praying to anybody on the stage. Would you just pray a simple prayer? If that's your heart, if you say, I know that it's my time to get saved, would you just pray a simple prayer? Just say, Dear Jesus, today I admit a spiritual poverty. I admit that I can't do this on my own. And today I humble myself and I turn from my sin. I put my faith in you, Jesus. Today, would you forgive me of my sin? Would you save me? And would you take me to heaven when I die? In the best way that I know how, Jesus, today I surrender my life to you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Well, today, if you just pray to receive Christ wherever you're at, we want to encourage you to text us. This is exactly how the 11 people have done it the last 2 weeks. If you'll just text us your first and last name, we're going to put up the number on every screen wherever you're at today. The number is 479-343-8777. And we're going to leave that up at all of our campuses even as we close the service today. Again, 479-343-8777. We ain't coming to your house. We're not going to do anything weird. All we want to do is begin a conversation with you about next steps in your newfound walk with the Lord Jesus. We're so excited for you. And so I'm going to ask at Springdale, Sean Smith, you go ahead and come up to the stage. At Pinnacle, Buster, you come up. And Phil, you come on up here at Fayetteville. And we will close this service, online service. Thank you guys for being a part of the day. You can hang around for the online lobby. We love you guys. Bye-bye.